Hi, ladies.
Testing.
1, 2, 3.
Good evening, ladies and ladies!
Welcome to the very first SheSays event for 2017. So who here is new? Just put your hand up. Yes, welcome to SheSays. I'm Mira, this is Lizzie.
Hello.
Before we even get started, can we just do a quick roll call as to which countries everyone's from? I'm from Singapore. Anyone from Singapore? Hopefully. Yes. Where are you from, Lizzie?
Global citizen.
Australia.
Yeah. Oh, come on, guys. You can be a little bit louder than that. Like.
That's very English of you.
You and me both.
What other countries do we have here tonight? New Zealand, okay.
Latvia.
What? Latvia.
Latvia, yeah. That's awesome.
The US? Oh, I'm so sorry. I really am.
Whatever you do, don't mention the Trump.
Just hang out here. Just hang out here. You'll be fine. And don't read the New York Times. India? Woo! Well. Denmark, okay. England, all right. Global citizen.
Okay, Italy. So tonight we've got a little bit of an interactive one. We're just going to strut around the stage. No, we're actually going to get everybody to look at the yellow thing, first of all. So Mira and I are just going to say a couple of things just to introduce what SheSays is. Watch out behind you. And then we're going to get the lovely panel to come sit here. They have water and wine, so it's going to be fine.
Amanda, I'm going to need you to click, click.
Got it.
What?
Before we start... SheSays Singapore is an awesome thing. We have all laughed so much tonight because this began with about 15 people, a very awkward thing where both Mira and I would try to tweet at the same time as asking the panel a question, so to make it feel like there were more people. And now there's all of you, and we're all a bit like, whoa.
And we used to do it in a shop house on Kyongsaik Road, and I still remember there was noise coming from the bar downstairs, so you couldn't hear anything. And it literally was 20 chairs. And since then, we've gotten, thanks to Farah, Jusco has come on board. We've got bottles XO for drinks, and we'll walk through all of that after this.
But it's not about us. It's actually about you guys, and that's the whole point of SheSays. So it's about getting more women into the creative digital marketing arenas. We do this because actually you guys ask the best questions. We'll have a panel tonight. We'll have 4-5 incredible people that will come and answer anything that you want. And that's the bit that I don't know about you, pride myself on, is that we're a community that are relaxed and everybody dares to ask the question.
So when it comes to SheSays, the way that most of our sessions run is going to be really interactive. And as you can tell, and you would have seen from the Facebook post, over the past couple of weeks, we were oversubscribed for this session multiple times. We actually have a waitlist of about 180 people as well. So congratulations on getting a ticket, and thank you for turning up and keeping to it.
You beat the rain. Go Singapore.
So if you want to tweet or if you have any questions that you know sometimes you may not want to ask outright, feel free to put it up on Twitter. And we've got a team at the back who are actually going to be tweeting, taking photos and things like that. We also have the hashtag, which is SheSaysSG.
Okay, so tonight we're going to do a quick hello. I think we may have just done that. We'll do a personal hello. So my name's Lizzie Hamer. I'm a creative director for a sports marketing agency called Octagon. I've actually been with SheSays for 5 years, LinkedIn now tells me. 3 years here in Singapore, and 2 years in Singapore, Australia. So it's been a really awesome journey, and I've met so many amazing women through it, but mainly because they're cool and they come up and tell me cool stuff. So that's the way that this thing works. It's super chilled. Don't intimidate the speakers, please. They'll never come back. Mira.
Hi, I'm Mira. I am with Accenture Digital. Oh, actually, Accenture now. I am with the digital team. It's just really confusing. Never mind. I'm with Accenture. I actually, if you are in comms or you're in PR or marketing, and you're wanting to make that move into technology, I did that about 2 years ago. I've been with SheSays now for about 3 years. Like, Lizzie and I kind of kicked off the Singapore thing together. And this is something that we love doing. as a side project, because I think that one of the things that we both pride ourselves on is how can we enable the community around us and how can we bring more women to the top. So tonight's speakers are very much in line with what we're trying to do as well. Vicky, where is Vicky?
Vicky, put your hands there in the air.
Hi guys, I'm Vicky. So I actually help Lizzie and Mira organize SheSays. We've been doing it for what, for me, 2 years now. So I work in Zaxis and product development in a programmatic company. So if you're interested in that, come and speak to me. On the side, I've been running Singapore's first and largest independent animation festival called Cartoons Underground for the past 5 years. And so if you guys are interested in independent animation or comics or art, feel free to reach out to me, because we're always looking at expanding the art scene in Singapore and promoting local talents overseas also.
Just so you guys know, the two most connected people in the world are Vicky and Mira. So they're the people to go and ask if you're looking for something new, if a little bit of advice, or just to be connected to the right people. We've also got a few people wearing lanyards tonight. Those little lanyards are yellow, and they say, "I'm part of the SheSays Singapore team." It's been awesome to bring more people into this kind of little wranglers, I'm going to call them, people that put this show together. So all volunteer and are willing to help you however you would like.
So to kick things off, we're going to introduce Far from Justco. So Justco's been sponsoring our venue for about 2 years now. So Far will give a quick introduction to business.
Mira. Hi guys, ladies and gentlemen, the very few gentlemen I see. Welcome to Justco. We are one of the best co-working spaces in Singapore. I'm biased, I know. But if this is your first time, I saw a couple of hands coming up just now. If this is your first time, welcome. We've been collaborating with SheSays for, like what Mira says, 2 years, and we are very proud to continue and support them for the whole year and many more years to come. Other than that, welcome and enjoy the show. Event, rather.
We've got a couple more people to say thank you to. Bottles XO.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thank you very kindly for downloading our app. If you don't already know, we have a range of boutique European wines and craft beers. Basically, thank you. The next time you need wine or craft beer, you just order on the app and we deliver to you within 1 hour. So guaranteed 1 hour delivery. Average delivery time is 29 minutes, no minimum order, no delivery fee. The bottles come chilled, ready to drink, and we deliver to wherever you are. So home, office, restaurant, park, sitting by the pool, wherever you are. So yes, thanks for downloading. Hope you've enjoyed your first glass free. You can purchase further glasses for $10. And we also have some little coupon cards that give you $10 off your first order after tonight. So thank you to SheSays and Justco for having us. We love being here and have a great night.
Okay, we've also got some really yummy food.
Yeah.
The guys here who are in the back over there have got an awesome concept. Come tell us all about it.
First of all, thanks for having us here. We're from Dosira. What Dosira actually means is a lunchbox in Korean. And traditionally, Dosira is actually a flat metal tin which always contains rice, veggie and meat. And then you pour in the gochujang and then you shake it to mix it. So what we did was we basically took that concept and we made it current. And we still retain the traditional recipes, but the methods of cooking are much cleaner. So it's a healthier way of presenting Korean cuisine to everyone. And we've priced it very affordably, you know, amazingly. Around this place, you can still get a rice bowl for actually less than $10 if you want to. But it scales up, and we have a variety of meat options that you can choose. We are available, we have a store over at China Square Central. Or if you would like to, you can actually order us from Uber Eats. And if you actually come to our little booth over there, we still have got like a bit more left. You can actually pick up like some sort of a special code that can give you some sort of offer from this year. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. All right. So what we're all
And I've got one
for.
Last thank you.
Sorry, to surprise you,
we've got an awesome guy behind the camera. We don't normally film these things, but there was such a demand that we thought we would. So a big round of applause for Engineers.SG.
On that note, so moving on. Jesus, Sonia. What's the clicker thing? All right. So just very quickly, so this is something that we just pulled off, off the web, right? When it comes to STEM, we're seeing a lot of women expressing an interest into going to computer science. I was talking to Lena, who's going to be, who is one of our speakers coming up here tonight. I think it was something like 20 to 30% of seats in university are female. And then when you go into your career, that drops to 20. And then when it comes to middle management, that's under 10. So there's a problem. And what we want to do today is not to talk about just the problem alone, but how do we address the situation? What are the solutions that we could build together as a community, and probably also based on what you guys have, you girls have asked, what are some of the solutions that we could build within our businesses to enable communities to better support women in technology? So first up, I'm going to start, have our panelists come to the front. If you could give them a warm round of applause.
I think they're blockaded in the back. I like it. It's like a revolution trying to get to the front. Super. Okay, so if anybody's looking forward to who's speaking tonight, their beautiful pictures are over here. There's obviously a lot of tweeting going on. Feel free to grab their handles and get them involved. I'm sure they'll reply afterwards. It's tech after all.
Right, so I think just very quickly, we're going to just do a round of introductions on who they are and what they do.
Sure, so hi, I'm Anika. I'm currently working at Uber. I'm the APAC and LATAM HR director, actually. I've been at Uber not quite 6 months. It's lovely to see so many women in this room tonight, because one of the things that I've found in the last 6 months is that I'm usually the only woman in the room. So this is wonderful, actually. Before Uber, I was...
I started my career actually in IT. I was a building coder many, many years ago. My first job was a software engineer. And from that, I actually moved to industry management consulting and talent in the organization space. And then from there, moved in-house into HR. So I also worked in London for about 5 years. I was in France for 10 years. My kids were born in France, and we moved here to Singapore just over 3 years ago. And I'm really happy to round of applause.
Hi, so I'm Lena from GovTech. So GovTech is basically the government technology agency. But beyond that, I spent most of my life in the private sector, mostly in American companies, and before that, in the local companies here in Singapore. Mostly here in Singapore, was spent a great amount of time in both East Coast and West Coast, the United States, as well as in India. And then I survived for a year in India and not 17. Yes. Yes. So I spent a bit now for me and the end of the month for about a year.
Pardon.
Hi everybody, I'm Lena Hoban. I'm really excited to be here tonight.
Like Mira, I'm an extension of digital. So I think our digital and other slides is focused on the
Too quiet.
My husband says I'm very quiet, unless I'm angry. So I lead our digital analytics alliances for APAC. So we focus on technologies and our partners for big data, visualization, and most recently, artificial intelligence, which we see as, I think, the next wave of the biggest disruption in technology. So prior to Singapore, I've been here for 5.5 years. I started my career in the US in Chicago, and I was in FS sales, focused on insurance and banking at Accenture. Was moved here about 5.5 years ago, where I had played a role in mobility product and offer development, and most recently, for the past 2 years, I'm in this current role. So I live here with my husband and 3 boys, and I don't know if there's a more convenient place than Singapore to have a career and 3 young boys. So thank you for having me.
You get 5 points for saying artificial intelligence first.
Hi, I'm John Neale. I run a recruitment business called McGregor, Boyall. Came here 4 years ago. It was a startup then. Prior to that, I had a business in Australia. And prior to that, I had a business in England, which is where I'm from. I left England in 2007 when the recession kicked in, as I was only 27 and I had no idea how to fix things once the recession did kick in. And that was 9 years ago. I was only supposed to be away for 6 months, so my mother and father aren't too happy. But it's been very, very positive in Singapore so far. We're working across Asia Pacific. And hopefully I can add some value today.
So, John, I'm a little biased here. John's a great recruiter, particularly because when I was actually thinking about making the switch, I spoke to him. I remember it was on Fox Street and we were talking about Elon Musk and space travel for about an hour. And then he just like called me the next day and said, hey, this is someone at Accenture who might actually be interested to speak to you. I didn't know who Accenture was at that point. I'm really sorry, but like, I knew you were the services I needed to receive, but it worked out beautifully. So if you've got any questions when it comes to what you should do with your career,
thank you, Mary.
You're welcome. Are you a single one? Oh, yes.
Steal that from you. Okay, so maybe to just kick things off, Lizzie found a really cool quote online. I wouldn't say it's cool, actually, but it's just interesting, and I want to know what your perspective is here. Kevin Roberts said that he doesn't see the lack of women in leadership roles in organizations being a problem. What do you think? And also looking at the path that you've taken in your careers, have you faced that issue or that conversation, or that statement? I think, Anika, maybe we'll want to start with you.
Does that work better? Yeah. So, yes, I think that's an issue. You know, the boss that I used to work for had this wonderful thing that she used to say to our leaders all the time, which was 36 does not equal 64. And that was a comment on the fact that in general society is, let's just say, about 50-50% women and men, yet only 36% of our company was women. This was the company I used to work for, not the one right now. Those numbers would be about half that, I think. And therefore, how could we say that we were a meritocracy? How could we say that we were in touch with the clients that we worked for? Because we didn't have people in our organization, and particularly not at leadership level, that could actually connect with, understand, and bring that perspective. So I actually think, absolutely feel, it's an issue to not have enough women in leadership. I think through my career, one of the things that I've noticed more than anything else is it starts at the top. So if you can get a diverse group of people, and by the way, I don't just think that's women, I also think that's, you know, other dimensions of diversity, whether it's geographic, whether it's, you know, experience. But if you don't get a diverse group of people that are sitting around the table making decisions, then one, you don't get innovation, right? Because everyone just nods their head when someone says something, because they all came from the same place, right? They all speak the same language. They all have the same perspective. So you don't get new, you don't get creative, you don't get thinking out of the box, you don't get kind of driving to the next level. And more than that, you don't get diversity below. because the people that they make decisions about, whether it's promotions or who's going to get this role or who are they going to hire, are the people that look like them. They're the people that they recognize. They're the people that are that have similar experience that they did. They're people that operate in the same way that they do. They're people that talk the same way they do. So I think the best way to actually, one, drive business performance at the end of the day through innovation is to make sure that you have a diverse group of people that are sitting around the table at the top.
You said one way already.
Do you want me to add on? Actually, I have a slightly different perspective. I think we do have quite a few CEOs in tech that are females, but I think it's the middle layer that's challenging. The kind of like leadership layer, beyond the corporate services bit, which is your HR, your finance, your comms. When you go to the actual marketing, the product development, tech roles, they tend to be more male leaders that's in the pipeline in terms of the succession planning. And to me, that's a real issue because, to Dierdre's point, I think it's really about advocating for each other and the homogeneous bit that people tend to hire whom they think look like themselves or think like themselves. And that's been challenging. And like what Mira said earlier, that in terms of the statistics that we have coming out from school, average of 4 out of 10 that attend a local polytechnic or university are actually girls in terms of STEM, tech curriculum. But it filters off to 3 out of 10 when they come out of school. And by the time they finish their first or second year of tech career, it drops to like 1 to 2 out of 10. So women tend to kind of like filter off once they realize they want to have a family and they realize that maybe tech has a long hours and they have more work-life balance, family needs. And that seems to be that perception that's kind of like instilled in women. And I think that's not true. It's something which we could challenge. Simply because I think it's just being brave enough to ask for what you deem as your rights and what you think you should do in order to succeed at your career. And it goes down to the empathetic bit, which at a recent WEF, the World Economic Forum, I can't remember which analyst actually put out this report that companies which hire or have more women leaders actually are able to deliver higher financial profits simply because women are more empathetic, and because they're more empathetic, they then tend to be more empathetic towards the customer user experience, and that actually translates into real financial results. And I think that's a great, great proof point that women leadership, it's really critical to the success of the companies. Yeah.
I think I probably agree a bit with both of you, but I think something interesting that John and I were talking about earlier was it kind of goes both ways. So on one side, it's definitely that senior leadership needs to set an example and be a bit more open to how they hire. But I think there also exists a bit of a fear for when you talk about things like technology and big data, those are topics that historically you think, okay, I will work in IT, I will be a coder, I'll be an engineer, but data and technology exists everywhere we are now. We use multiple devices. Southeast Asia is first in mobile, even beyond first-tier markets like the US and UK. So we need to start thinking about data and technology as an environment that we all really belong in, rather than it having this perception with a lot of fresh graduates that think they need to learn coding or engineering. It's a concept that we all need to understand. So we were talking about if you say something like big data, people might think that they have to actually pursue a degree that states big data. They have a lot of master's degrees that focus on data. But actually, if we change that conversation and actually talk about behavioral trends, that opens a lot of doors to people who work in marketing, communications, psychology, because actually what we work in is the art of audience targeting. It's the art of people into data. So I think that starts opening doors from a lot of people just from a perception point of view.
So I guess just to add to what Anika, Lena, and Dierdre said, I think the point that Lena made around adding diversity, especially in the room. So given that in technology, there's a majority of men who hold the leadership positions, and of course, when you throw out ideas, they get validated. It's kind of the same synonymous thinking. So my dad, for example, he always thinks he's right. And he says, because my friends, they like my comments on Facebook, even though they're very insightful. And my comment back to him is, well, you hang out with the same friends, you surround yourself with the same friends who think similar to you. So you think that everything you say is validated. So I think having more women in leadership positions in the workforce gives some sort of quality assurance. I guess we'll go a little technical here. So I think it adds, you know, to the QA a bit. And I'm not technical, actually. And one of the reasons why I think my career counselor, he keeps inspiring me to continue in these technology roles is because Accenture really prides itself on innovation. And with innovation, you need a lot of diverse thinking. And I think not only women, but good women. So I want to make sure that we stress we're not just putting women in the workforce, but good quality women who actually have the content and knowledge. You know, I think that's what I really want to make sure that we focus on.
Yeah, I think you know, diversity, like Anika was talking about, is extremely important for new ideas. But there is a definite lack of strategy around most businesses, and obviously working within recruitment, I work with a lot of different companies in a lot of different industry sectors. One of the scarier things that I found this week, doing a lot of research and calling some of my customers, some of my clients that I work with, both here in Singapore and across Asia Pacific, was there's not a lot of structure or strategy around how to promote the female workforce within technology. There's a lot of gestures. There's a lot of we need to hire more women, but there doesn't seem to be a huge amount of strategy that the businesses have created that they're then going to implement, carry out to do this. And I think a lot of this is going to have to go back down almost to kind of that high school area, whereby perhaps the marketing of what it is to have a career in technology is taken to kids, basically. So the degrees that they choose to take will perhaps have a technology lean, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to be a coder or a programmer. It means, you know, there's a lot of sexy jobs out there for technologists. You don't have to be, like I say, a hands-on, somebody who fixes a laptop or somebody who, you know, writes Java code. So I just think it's an educational process from school all the way through to, you know, MNC businesses and the small to medium businesses. And it's a process that we're all going to have to champion.
So just really quickly, looking at the placements, well, for John and Anika, looking at the placements that you've done within your business in, say, the past few months, can you give us kind of like a number on how many of them were female in comparison to men?
I can. I checked today.
He's diversity. We're getting raped by this.
I don't think I'm allowed to answer that question. So I would say, so I've been at my company now for not quite 6 months. And one of the first things I noticed when I came in was, again, at the senior level, there just were no women. I think there was one other director that was a woman, and there were, I think, one general manager of our countries that was a woman. So in 6 months, I'm very happy to say that we have added two female directors. We've promoted one, and we have two additional GMs that are women. And I don't think that's just obviously because of me. I haven't been there that long. But what I do know is there's some even just very subtle changes in terms of the conversation and the process that can be made in order to help drive the right outcomes. So I was chatting a little bit to John beforehand, and again, back to the point that if you only have a group of men who are making decisions, and you only have a group of men that are interviewing a senior woman, then she may not particularly want to come and work for you, right? No matter how much you're going to pay her, because she doesn't really think that maybe that's a culture that's going to be inclusive or recognize. So by making sure that we have someone in the interview process, that maybe we're a little bit more high touch, that we work with agencies to make sure we have a diverse pipeline, that we have someone who goes back and does a second check. Just little changes like this can actually make a very big difference in terms of the outcome.
I looked at the statistics for 2016, so it wasn't a couple of months, it was the whole year, and again, working across a lot of different industry sectors and working across a number of different disciplines within IT, we placed 34 females into technology roles last year, which is 22% of the placements we made. I was given this evening's event, I was quite relieved at that figure, because it's actually quite respectable. And we are mandated by a lot of our clients, again, to say, can you provide us with female candidates? But sometimes it does feel like I mentioned in my previous comments, it's a gesture. Can we provide us with some female candidates to make up the numbers? Because who are you appeasing? We have to be reactionary to what our customers want within the external recruitment industry. But there are some exceptional candidates out there. There's some exceptional technology professionals who are female in this market. And whenever I meet those individuals, I know that they're going to be they're going to be highly desirable to the businesses that I work with. So the statistics weren't too bad from my business's point of view.
So I'm going to throw this to Dierdre now. When it came to you interviewing with Google, how did you address the topic of diversity in your interview? And when it comes to actually now working in the business, how do you think that the women who are in leadership positions and yourself have worked towards going up the corporate ladder with your skill set?
So I think when I actually interviewed for the role, I've always worked in tech, so it was really a no-brainer. I don't think it was a consideration when I actually went through the interview process, and I think it wasn't until after I started in the role that I started recognizing areas where, as an organization, we could be better at gender diversity. And that also applies across cultural diversity. I think one of the big challenges that corporations have in Singapore is the split between expat hires versus local hires. So we're not just talking about gender anymore, it also applies to cultural diversity. I think it took me a while to recognize that was a challenge, but it was also a perception that a lot of my colleagues also shared. So we actually did an internal evaluation against just in technology, how much senior leadership was there in for women across Asia Pacific, and it was 2 people for an organization of 250 people. So it's actually been something that's been recognized by our senior leadership. So what they've done is actually internally created a network for women at ad tech. And this is not a group that's specifically open only to women. It's actually open to anyone who really stands for diversity. And then building that network out and understanding what is the support system that we can start building, whether it means things like cross-country networking, whether it's mentorship, which I think is really important to hear the experience of other people and understand like what their challenges have been in climbing a corporate ladder. I think the fact that it's been recognized is the first step. A lot of times there's unconscious bias with senior leadership. It's not that people are actively trying to discriminate against women, but the challenge is, sometimes senior leadership might go, let's go play a game of golf. If the women don't know how to play golf, they automatically get excluded from that activity. So even just bringing that awareness to senior leadership, I think, has been a big step for us. I don't think we've resolved it necessarily, but I think we're kind of on a better pathway than we have been in the last 3 years I've been there. But obviously, it's taken 3 years for us to really get there. So I'm really excited to see where we really take that across the region. If it's been at the senior levels, it's been recognized, then there's obviously going to be action taken against it all through the organization. Yeah.
So I'm going to ask Rhea, how have you managed? So I kind of look up to Rhea a lot because she's got 3 boys under the age of, is it 6?
4-2-1.
Yeah, 4-2-1. She's got an amazing job with Accenture. She's really well recognized within the business for the work that she does. So how have you, that's quite a lot already. Three boys at home is quite a lot to deal with. And then how do you manage the work-life balance, and how have you built a network within your business to be successful?
Amira, thank you. That's a lot of praise I think I may not deserve. So I think it's, for me, I've been very fortunate to align myself with very strong and very open-minded leadership. And at least with Accenture, it's a very highly matrixed organization. We're large. We have 5 different businesses, I guess, within Accenture, which is basically like 5 different businesses within an organization. And you need to, unfortunately, be very political, but also deliver high results. So being a working mom, I think it's, there's 2 things. One, the leadership that I mentioned, aligning yourself to the right leadership and getting that support. And 2, setting the right expectations. So my current role, I manage our partners for APAC. And prior to that, I was in a sales role where it could potentially mean the same day I would have to fly out and be on a client site outside of Singapore. So for me, I had to sit back, speak to my family, speak to my leads, and really reflect on whether or not at that point in my life, that was something that I could actually succeed at. So luckily for me, I think, and that's why networking and, you know, attending events like this is very important, because you need to expose yourself and be aware of the opportunities that are out there, because, you know, any day your current situation could be very different. I moved to Singapore 5.5 years ago through Accenture, and 3 months later, I found out that I was pregnant with my first son. So you can only imagine how excited my team was in receiving that news. But I think we managed it. We found we were able to divide, I guess, and conquer some of my workload, and also create a transition plan. But again, it was early expectations, much sooner than later. I think some of the reactions on my team, unfortunately, I didn't anticipate. Not all of them were positive, but you can't make everyone happy. So I think one of the big things for me is you really can't get down if, you know, someone may not like you on the team, someone has different expectations of you than, you know, you may have set forth. But leadership, expectations, and really understanding what you can manage on your own and be successful at it. Because Mira asked before this session what one of the philosophies or tenets were that have really guided me throughout my career. And one has been, it's not necessarily a quote, but the negativity bias. So I was pre-med. I was a psychology major, biology minor, and I'm in tech. So if I can do it, anyone can. But the negativity bias states that it takes 5 positive instances to make up for 1 negative instance. So your brain is trained to really focus on negativity in terms of remembering it. And I think a lot of our experiences are based on how you remember it, how you reflect on it, not necessarily what actually happened. So the biggest thing to focus on is what can you do and do well and be recognized for it to defend, I guess, whether it's your career moves or other changes or flexibility. So in Accenture, they offer work-life balance, which is great. You can either work from home or you can work at the client site or at the Accenture office, but the big thing that we focus on is results. So as long as you're delivering results in a positive manner and adding value to the client, then I think you're pretty clear.
Yeah. Okay, it's interesting you bring up the negativity thing. I like it. Mainly because I'm about to throw a massive question about gender bias and should we be pro-female. While you're thinking about your answer, I want to know your best day. Like, why do you work in tech? I know of you guys, you have amazing roles, but like, what is it? Like, why do I want to be a woman in tech right now? Throwing to that end.
Oh,
I was pausing to think. Well, I'd say two things to that. First of all, I love the fact that this industry is one that just is growing at an amazing pace. And I think the innovation at a company like Accenture or a company like Uber, where we are creating and disrupting and, you know, breaking down barriers and doing different things, not just in terms of the product, but also in terms of the way we organize or the way we approach something like HR. I'd say secondly, though, at my heart, I think I'm a people person. And so what's even, I guess, my more important for me is actually that I'm an HR professional. I love the fact that I do that in tech, but first and foremost, actually, I really love working with people and helping people reach their potential every day.
Okay, instead of going down the line, because I like to break patterns, I'm going to throw to you. Why do you like to be a woman in tech?
You stole my line. Actually quite similar to Anika. I mean, from my point of view, it's about working with people. If you don't like working with people and talking to lots of people, then I'd advise you not to work in recruitment.
Why would any one of these women want to work in tech?
In tech?
From your point of view.
Well, it depends, but they're going to define tech for me. What does that mean to you?
2017, it's everywhere.
Oh, that's right, digitalization, amazing. Yeah, because from my point of view, I was never necessarily that interested in technology when I started 15 years ago. But technology was, for me, it was like I kind of articulated earlier, that I felt that technology meant, I felt technology meant, you know, programming, and it meant IT support, it meant things like that. For me, the online businesses are very, very exciting. They're very interesting. The analytics side of things is very, very interesting to me in terms of the psychology of what people use technology for. If it's from a retail or an e-commerce point of view, you know, what are the trends in people's behavioral patterns? And then obviously the terrifying, you know, emerging technologies like IoT, which I try not to think about too much, because obviously that means that everybody's inside your head, effectively. But yeah, look, it's about working with people, and it's about effectively helping people progress within their careers, regardless of gender or nationality or ethnic background. That's pretty much it for me.
It's about impact for me. I mean, I remember, 20 years ago when I was that young, fresh grad in a product role, trying to get people to SMS, if you guys even remember what that is. And it was really challenging from a user behavior, to John's point around, like, you SMS your friends trying to get them to start SMSing and they'll call you back like, what do you want? And I'm like, no, we got to start a text conversation. It's not about calling, it's about text conversation and how technology has evolved, and with that, our connections with each other, and how scalable and how impactful that has been on all our lives. I think that's powerful. I mean, being a mom myself, I mean, in my old roles, old jobs, where I was traveling quite a bit, and being able to Skype with my son, that was priceless, and that's all due to technology. And with every kind of like milestone, with every transition you make, and all these are made possible through the seamless technology. People, especially in the technology world, I realize that people don't tend to complain until something breaks down. So you don't really feel like you're recognized until there's a problem that happens and suddenly like, oh, it's the tech guys. So to me, it's like people don't realize how important technology is till you actually suffer a breakdown, unfortunately. But that also shows the amount of impact we have on the rest of everyone else. Yeah.
On that positive note, I'm just going to refill the speaker's glasses as we go to the next person.
So to add a kind of like technical point of view on that, around artificial intelligence, which I know excites you.
It does.
But I don't know if many of you are reading the latest news or have kept up with, I guess, like Facebook Live. And I'm from Chicago, and Chicago, unfortunately, has had its bad string of violent events. And Facebook Live, where there were a group of teenagers who were streaming this very violent act to a a mentally challenged teenager was very disturbing. But Facebook is now using artificial intelligence to try and predict violent, I guess, feeds, and predict that from being liked and actually shut it down immediately. Because we definitely don't want to condone this type of behavior. And one of the things that excites me about technology is really using technology to solve everyday problems, you know, at scale, lower cost, ready to. And one of those things is also in medicine. So tumors, for example, I think Philips and Google are working on some very innovative technologies that can help predict and cite tumors before even doctors can, and way earlier. So that means saving lives. So I think it's very important, because when lives are saved, you know, it promotes less violence, and it really impacts and disrupts, I think, our everyday lives.
Cool. I think I kind of agree with that on kind of twofold. So the first bit around being able to understand human behavior better. We've basically put a number against every form of behavior that we have in the world. So being able to understand how people work together, how people work against each other, it's basically the economics of behavior. That's one side of it. But then the second piece is the kind of the availability of information. I think as a generation, we're able to elevate our knowledge and our understanding of the world by having access to information. So you think about people in countries that historically didn't have access to books, but now have access to the internet. Obviously, depending on how you use that information or ensure that the quality of information is there, obviously, you know, a lot of the conversation now is around fake news and how social sites are kind of promoting things like fake news. So obviously, there needs to be taken steps that need to be taken to improve that. But just the pure availability of information to anyone can access it. You don't have to be going to university, you don't have to go to grad school, but you can readily access information at your fingertips.
So it's almost like technologies have the ability to democratize entire society. It makes education more accessible. Whilst we're on the topic of accessibility, I think that there are a lot of women in the room here today who have expressed either they're already in technology and they're looking at how can I move up in my career, or if you're coming from a non-tech role, for someone who's say in marketing or comms, how are they going to make that shift into a technology business, and how would they be able to kind of what would be the skill sets that you would identify for them as
responsible? Anika, do you want to go first?
I'll go first. My point of view is learning agility is the most important skill that you can have. My 9-year-old daughter is teaching herself to code at the moment. I don't even know what she's coding in, but she's coding in something. My 11-year-old is definitely like programming things that I don't think I was even doing as a graduate. Anyone can learn technology online, teach themselves how to do that. The best skill that you can bring to any job is learning agility. The second thing, and this is where I think women actually have a big advantage, right? We've talked a lot about how women don't have the advantage, but there's a place where women really do have the advantage, and that's in EQ. And I really do think that women in general, big generalization, are more attuned to what is going on around them. They are more attuned to the impact that they have on a room when they say something. And they are more attuned to how people are reacting to what's going on. I have seen so many men in my career have no idea that they are putting everybody around the table completely offside as they continue onwards and onwards. And all the women are sitting there cringing because they understand what's going on and no one else is. So I think bringing that, again, in any industry, but particularly in an industry that happens to be rather male-dominated, is a huge advantage that you bring to the table.
Okay, so did you mention how do you move up the hierarchical ladder, is that? Okay, I mean, one of the things that most people don't do, which sounds really obvious, but is you ask your manager to create a career progression program for them. You know, there shouldn't just be one way upwards, there should be multiple. Unfortunately, what you then have to do is you have to rely on the creativity, the hard work, the effort, the thoughtfulness of your manager. And that's not necessarily a common trait that people have in general, not just technology, not just business. But yeah, you've got to ask. You've got to push yourself sometimes and say, look, I would like opportunities to diversify my skill set, to learn more. As you mentioned, obviously, learning agility. It sounds really, really simple, but you've got to get the guts to do it and just say, look, I'd like to know how this business will support me in progressing.
So how do you have that conversation? Because I mean, for me, I don't know how to have that conversation.
I know you don't.
That was a side conversation. But yeah, so how do you have that conversation?
At the end of the day, sometimes it's difficult to ask for support, no matter what kind of forum that is in. You've got to be a little bit humble and just ask for help. You know, it sounds really, really straightforward, but most people don't do it because of, I don't know, maybe there's a psychological lack of willingness to reach out. But if you are ambitious, and if you do have a good attitude, then that will be recognized by the people that work around you and who you work for. And it's, you know, those are the qualities that are required for somebody to progress.
Can I say one thing? Sorry. Really, I mean, this will sound really like obvious and like motherhood and apple pie, but like who has a sponsor and who has a mentor,
yeah,
right? Really, really simple things, like doesn't have to be someone, even in the company that you work with, but find a mentor that you can go and have these conversations with and can help you figure out like how you can get it on the table and who you should be having it with, and find someone in the organization that will sponsor you, right? And that's the, you know, I think a very, very easy,
absolutely,
you know, tactical way.
Can you explain what sponsor is other than an A? It's a word that not everybody uses.
So a sponsor is someone who is senior in the organization who thinks really highly of you and has your back. And again, when those meetings are happening, whether they're hiring decisions, promotion decisions, or rating decisions, is going to be the person that speaks up for you. Typically, they're not someone that you may report into, but someone who, you know, has their eye on you, maybe recognizes a little bit about themselves when they were younger, thinks you have great potential, and will go into bat for you. So a mentor is more like someone that you would go to for advice and coaching, you know, have confidential discussions about, you know, how do I put this topic on the table? How do I have this discussion with my boss? How do I, you know, manage coming back from maternity leave? Or how do I talk about the fact that I need to go and do this other thing in my life?
Do we have any questions from the floor just yet?
Yes. I hope I articulate it properly, and I'm sorry. Thanks. I think I'm loud enough about it, but I need to. Sorry, I was just trying to work out how to articulate this, and it takes us somewhat out of tech specifically, but it was something, Lena, that you said earlier, and then something that John just said now as well. You said that if you look at graduates who are working and who are in tech, that the number keeps dropping. And when they get into the workplace, you said the number drops by about 50%. And sorry to single you out, but the comment that went alongside with that was that happens, you know, at that time, maybe many of them are having considerations about having families. And you used the term working mother earlier, and I think we never say working father. And the number of men working in the industry doesn't drop by half because they're thinking about having children. So to John's point about actually just kind of having the guts to go for it, how much of it is our individual responsibility to say, this parenting gig is 50-50 and you have just as much parenting responsibilities as I do? Why? It just feels like we overlook, you know, and whether that's in the financial services industry or in tech or in any industry, it's still this underlying assumption that men definitely have, I think, and so many women have, that we take the burden on ourselves, well, I'm going to have to take it into consideration that when I have kids, I'm going to have to slash my hours. So how much of it is us just saying, no, this is a two-way street, and if you want to have kids, you have to commit just as much time?
So can I respond to that quickly?
Ever known, noticed that dads always babysit kids?
No. So I was hoping that I might be able to squeeze this into the conversation today. So I think when we talk about women in leadership roles within technology, or in fact any industry, I think there is a large number of women who don't return to work, you know, when they start families, but women who have progressed really, really well in their careers. And with modern industry, you know, even the banks with all their paranoia, they'll still let you work from mobile devices, they'll let you work from home, you know, you don't have to be at the office 5 days a week. I think that's an area where, you know, every market, not just Singapore, could tap into. It's about encouraging women to come back to work, even if only in a part-time basis. You know, women who are in senior positions, because, again, going back to an earlier comment that Anika made, you know, people do hire what is familiar to them. Whether or not you're, you know, a white guy from England, maybe I hire white English guys, or whether or not, you know, you're female, or whatever it is. But with more women in leadership positions, hopefully it will be much more natural to encourage progression for the female workforce. So if we can bring back people, you know, and maybe like you say, share some of the parenting responsibilities, or, you know, what men going back to work, men staying in work. Regardless, there's an untapped resource there, I think, that perhaps we could utilize and come up with some plans about how to, you know, effectively make a big difference.
So Cheryl Sadler very famously said that one of the
critical success factors of a woman's career is the man that she chooses to marry, right? And I do think that there is that plays a fairly significant role. And I remember when I had my first child and I went back to work, and there was a lot of discussion with my husband around who was going to do what. And at the time we were living in France, and we would sit down on a Sunday evening and figure out who would have to stay in the morning before the nanny came, and who would leave work early to come home before so the nanny could leave. And I remember saying to him at the time, because we both had, you know, fairly big jobs and fairly big teams, it makes such a bigger impact for you and your work when you leave to come home than it does when I leave my job to come home. Because he was sitting there as a manager of, you know, a group of, you know, 20, 25 people in France. And so when he left at 5 o'clock to come home from the nanny, that was a huge statement. So I do think, like, having these conversations and, like, really figuring out what you need to do together. Yeah, absolutely.
That's where I got to put in the plug for Singapore. It's about the only place in the world where you could have a family, have a great ecosystem, great help, and yet have a great job. I mean, that's how I chose to kind of like relocate back here, because, yeah, you could get help. It's like real help. You could go to work. You don't need to worry about the food. You don't need to worry about the education. It's like, it's all about outsourcing model, and that worked perfectly fine for me and my husband.
So I have a quick question, actually, that actually might be quite fitting for all of you. I think one of the questions actually came up from one of the women here who's kind of seen what she's about. It was a consulting question. When you look at consulting as a whole, and even if you're within a technology company, and this includes agency folks, one of the big things that we get is billable hours. Every single minute that you're spending on an account, why you're being chosen to work on an account, is because you're going to be able to commit to the client, meet all their needs, you know, all of that. If you're a working mom, especially at the beginning, there have been women in this room who said that they were not recommended for a team that they wanted to work on, purely because they were seen as not being up to the mark. And how do you manage that conversation if that does come up?
I would just say, after I had my kids, I think I became like 10 times more effective
right? You just like stop having coffee and like chatting with people around and like doing email. You just do the shit that you need to do and you get out of there as soon as possible.
People person number.
I think Anika nails it on the head. It's really efficiency in maximizing your time. But also, like, I think the big thing is just doing something that you can do at this point, maybe in this stage, that you know you're good at. One of the hesitations that I had when I was going into AI, like as a sub role, so Accenture has a great, I think, We're pretty lucrative because we always have sub roles that we don't get paid for extra. So AI is a sub role that I took on. But again, there's risks to that because I'm new, I'm not in tech. But I was mostly scared because I was afraid that I wasn't going to do an excellent job. And it brings me back to the original question where I think it's, we set such high expectations for ourselves. I know men do as well. But it doesn't always have to be perfect. So today, for example, I flew in from Tokyo. I was in Tokyo last week. My husband and I had a high level of coordination because he flew out to Seoul right when I landed from Tokyo last week. And I think Anika really, I very much agree with it's who you marry who has a very big impact on your career. But again, at the same time, if your expectations were not met when you have kids, then you can manage it a bit better. But again, it makes it a bit more challenging. I'm really lucky to have a husband who's very supportive. He's actually here right now. And I can't believe I'm speaking in front of him. But it's really having that support system, but also communicating. So even in work and in relationships, it's communicating and making sure you guys understand each other, because I can say something, he can say something, and we just don't get each other. But with the family, and adding to Lena's point, Singapore, it makes it pretty efficient because you can outsource some of those mundane tasks to your helper, for example. So I think we're seeing more women here in leadership positions than when I speak to my colleagues in Chicago, where they have to be very strict on 8 to 5. I think there's some flexibility here that we could leverage and take advantage of to take some steps forward, but some of it is in our heads, in my head. I was really afraid that the house would burn down and the kids would starve last week and this week, but it didn't happen. So thank you, but I don't know why I had that in my head. I think it's because I always assume those roles with planning the meals, with activities, and I never let my husband really do it unless it was necessary, and he did a great job, so.
Don't go with a high five of clap.
We're going to throw to the question at the back.
At the back, and then we'll come to
you. Who stole my mic?
I think it's mainly been covered, but I was just going to echo, I think it's all about decisions and the fact that you get to do leadership roles because you've got the support. And it isn't always down to a feminist thing. It might be down to practicality, that sometimes you do have to take a back seat because you've chosen to have a family, or sometimes your partner will, but it depends on your circumstances at the time, but also the support that you get at the time. And it does take a great, you know, a relationship to enable you to do that leadership role. I've been fortunate back in the UK and here that my colleagues have been really supportive as well. I've not had to worry about being a mother or not pulling my weight because I've had the flexibility. Different countries have different mindsets as well. But I've been fortunate as well here to find a role where they have been tolerant of me being a mother as well as being a wife, and it's worked out. But I think it takes compromise and it takes work on both parties.
Completely agree. I'm going to throw to the top of the stairs.
From the cheap seats.
All of the gods for a reason.
I have to say, I couldn't agree more about, you know, having a husband or a partner who supports you. But I would like to add to that. I think you need to have a boss or a leadership level or a mentor. Your leader needs to be somebody who supports family as well, and that is equally important. So I have two small children, I have two boys. As I left the workforce on a permanent basis, consulting with other people, ultimate poor feedback was knowing that I had a boss who has a family, who values family, and was more than happy for me to be wherever I needed to be at whatever time, provided the job was being done well. So I would say, don't just choose your husband, choose your boss.
I'm going to build on that and actually throw a question, being that should we actually be gender biased? Like, so it's nice enough to have somebody that looks after you in your company, and it's quite nice to come to a free event. Yay, we're doing stuff for women. But should there actually be legislation? Like, should these big companies say, no, it should be a 50-50 split in all creative departments? Sorry, I only know creativity. Like, should there actually be hardcore legislation put in place? Should we put a line in the sand and go, no, you have to hit this quota?
still thinking about it. I don't know. I think I have to think about that a bit. I'm not sure that... I guess the concern would be... I mean, the first thing I think of is affirmative action in the US. So when schools actually place people into their organization, they look at racial diversity. Whether I agree or not, I'm still on the fence. My concern with putting that in a limelight is, do we set ourselves back by, you know, saying, you know, we get a handicap because we're women? But at the same time, I think there are challenges that are hard to overcome individually, and we need support from people like senior management to actually put their foot down. Back to the example around our organization building a kind of a group for women in ad tech, that had to happen before anyone really recognized the issue. Whether it means there's a law in place, I think I still have to think about whether I agree or not, but I think there definitely has to be recognition at the senior level. Otherwise, it's always going to come back to the fact that, you know, if you're an individual and you don't drive your own career, no one's going to help you drive it. But I think even looking around the room right now, there's so many women here who believe in the same thing and who support each other. Like, this is a great start in itself in terms of giving women, you know, the ability to connect on things like mentorship, on things like industry, on things like passions. And then if in your organization you have senior leadership backing that, then I think, you know, a combination of those two things are necessary for us to be able to grow in this area.
So I guess I would say two things on this topic. When I was at my previous company, we actually did have there a very clear and a very vocal strategy around diversity, and had for many years. I think it was one of the more progressive companies in the tech space. Yet we made practically no progress whatsoever, right? It was baby steps. We'd go from like 22.1% to 22.4% at the end of the year and then pat ourselves on the back. So that was the first thing. The second thing, at that same company, there was a point in my career back in France where I was on two different leadership teams within the geography that I was in. One, relatively diverse. There was, I think, two or three other women and a bunch of different nationalities and probably range of ages that were sitting around the table. The other one was me and a bunch of white, middle-aged European men. And the difference in the discussion that would happen in those two groups on sometimes exactly the same topic was unbelievable to me. The fact that in one group I could open my mouth and be like, no one had heard a thing that I had said, or even no one would even want me to put the topic on the table. I remember one of my first meetings, I said to them, so we're going to talk about diversity, and my boss said to me, we don't have a diversity problem here. And I was like, are you kidding me? Like, I don't know how you define diversity, but it's not what we have around this table. So I think, although it is complicated, although it is very politically charged, and although it can lead to some very negative, unintentional consequences, if you want to drive change, you need to disrupt. And you need to make some kind of intervention sometimes in order to get to a point where the change is sustainable and it will just, you know, profit and create and enable itself.
But if you are so far behind on getting there, then I think, yes, you should put a quota in and you should just, you know, drive some intervention in order to get a group of people that sit around the table so that then the change can actually be enabled.
I feel like a job.
He's
Do we have any other questions?
I kind of fixated on the quota question that you asked, and that's because obviously coming from the UK market, they have rolled out that model in terms of this percentage of your workforce must be female, this percentage of your workforce must be of this background, etc., etc. Again, the problem comes back to the individual hiring manager or manager. A lot of people are lazy, so they will fill their quota without necessarily trying to achieve progress. I don't have a solution yet. I'm still thinking about it, but I don't think the quota system is necessarily the right answer.
General Mills put out a pitch in the USA, and they said that the advertising company that had to have a 50-50 gender split in the creative department, and it had to have a 20% diverse, I think, across the entire agency. So we're starting to see mandates come through. I actually stand by them. I think it's a fascinating one, because, like you say, that whole sort of piece around our biases, like, would you hire a female who scored a 5 out of 10 versus a guy who scored a 6 out of 10? Like, when those two are scoring so interestingly close, but one knows how to self-promote and the other doesn't, like, okay, cool, I'll have a check.
Well, hiring is objective anyway, so, I mean, again, it's very, very difficult. If you're looking at workforce optimization, then a diverse workforce would be very difficult to look at the analytics, the statistics around, if I'd have hired that person, would my business be, would have it benefited more than if I'd hired this person? Because these are all hypothetical scenarios that cannot be answered. I think at the end of the day, there's just a responsibility to educate, and technology in particular, hopefully the balance can be weighed back towards at the school level. Like I said, it's about maybe more education about bringing more people into the industry.
Okay, so
we've got a
question over there.
Hello everyone, my name is Laura. I work in people development, and I had a question actually for Anika. You spoke about sponsorship and mentorship, and I was just wondering, since you're HR director, what are some of the initiatives that you have put in place or that you want to put in place in order to foster more diversity and sort of create equal chances for the few women that you have in the organization? Because I think one thing is hiring, the other thing is, as other people mentioned, like retention, and how do you promote or help women grow in the organization? And aside from that, like, do you also have any advice for all the women in the room as to what kind of initiatives we can suggest within our companies or try to initiate in order to, you know, put in place this kind of structure? Thank you.
That was a very long question.
Sorry.
So I think there does need to be like some programmatic things that a company has in order to support women, and particularly we spoke earlier about, you know, wanting to start a family and maybe, you know, coming back from maternity leave. And so, you know, having proper maternity leave as a starting point is really important. I don't think you can come back to work with having a 3-month-old baby. I don't think that's enough time. So I'm a huge proponent of giving women just physically a little bit more time to get themselves together and their shit together before they have to, like, come into the office and talk to adults again. I think providing, you know, some nurturing when women come back from maternity leave, and so, you know, at a company like Accenture, they're not, you know, put on a plane and set off to Japan and, you know, trying to figure out how they can pump while they're traveling and, you know, going to different client sites or whatever it is. I mean, there's just some simple programmatic things that we can put in place to be more mindful of where people are in their careers, and that's really not that difficult. Secondly, I'm a huge believer in having networking programs. So, you know, things like this that are outside of the companies that you work in, where women can come together and talk and share and realize, oh, wow, it's not just me, right? There's other people who think that way or don't know how to ask that question or have, you know, been struggling with, you know, how to approach this problem. Like, men have had these for years, right? Someone mentioned playing golf earlier, you know, coming from the UK where there's all these special boys' clubs and boys' schools. And, you know, I think we've all seen different types or different incarnations of that across different cultures or different companies. And so I think we should create our own in whatever format they are. And then thirdly, putting in place some informal or formal mentoring programs. So it is something that we're trying to put in place at the moment in Uber. It didn't exist before. I know it was something we had at Accenture. It's something we've done with some external organizations as well. And I think giving women access to, you know, senior women or men for that matter, who can be role models and who can guide them and coach them is always a great thing.
Thank you. Yes.
It just reminded me of an example of in my old job in Microsoft, where I had a really senior mentor, and I don't know whether there are people from Microsoft here, but anyway, so okay, so I shouldn't name names, but basically, so she was offered this really big job, and The competitor that was going for the same job said that, yeah, he's 300% ready for the job. And the mentor that offered her the job told the mentor that, I don't think I'm ready, even though the mentor told her that you're way ahead of the guy. She took a week to think about it, and she went back to the boss and said, I think I'm like 150% ready for the job. And he took a leap of faith and he gave her the job, even though the other guy that was going for the job said he was 300% ready for the job. And sorry, not to stereotype any male in the room here, but men tend to have that confidence to like really kind of like package and brand and kind of like overstate like they are all ready to like... deliver on it when they might actually not know how to. And girls, we just tend to need that over assurance that we kind of like need to know three times more than we need to in order to deliver on the job. And it just boils down to that bravery and just having that confidence in ourselves. So it's beyond policies, I think.
I think Sheryl Sandberg also said that, right, in the book. It's like, you know, if a woman goes for a role, she's going to go through every single JD, and I have all been there, right? Go through all the JD, you're checking everything. But then the guy next to you will say, and she's like, yeah, I can do it. No big deal.
They did the same study at Google with engineers. So the engineering program at Google, you basically have to self-nominate if you want a promotion. So they found that women who were eligible for promotion were 10 to 20% less likely to put themselves up. And men who maybe scored against 2 out of 5 of the characteristics they were looking for automatically put themselves up for promotion. So it goes back to that EQ. You don't want to take on a job that you're not going to be able to fulfill, whereas men have the confidence to say, I will eventually be able to fulfill that and I'm going to put my name into the hat.
A specific question on that topic. So based on the comparison of how men achieve things and how women achieve things, what are your personal opinions on how much women should, because that's a comparison in itself, how much women should compare themselves to take that type of behavior versus maybe being themselves as women, which is more of a kind of helping others and empathizing kind of nature versus, you know, helping myself type behavior?
So for me, I live by a personal motto. So one thing, I was actually telling John this earlier, one thing that I live by is I'll look through my emails that I'm about to send out, I'll check them before I send them out, and I'll find all the points that I've apologized for something I'm not sorry for. So again, buffer words like just or like, or say I have to move a meeting and I say, oh, I'm really sorry, can I move this? actually I can take that out and say, I have another commitment. Can we move this to another time? So rather than apologizing for something I've not made a mistake on and saving that for a moment where I've actually made an error, I think that's a really, really simple change that I've kind of taken on as my personal motto. In terms of like how you evaluate how much you should, you know, be yourself versus, you know, take on, like, take the same attitude that a man would have, I think that's all really subjective. It's all really up to you how you want to figure that out. And what I really have lived by in my career is looking to women in my organization or outside of my organization that I really respect, that I want to emulate, and I see how they behave in meetings. And I try to really live by that motto as well, just to have someone that I want to look up to and understand how they would handle the same situation. So I always think in my head, what would they do in this situation? And then I try to push myself to do that as well.
Question, I think, next.
Hi, my name is Larry, and very, very insightful comments from all of you. My question is basically, I'm just going to come out and say it, how do you land a job at your company? So allow me to explain, you know, as a woman in early 20s, it's a very frustrating age because you're in between. You have got some experience, but not that much experience. So, you know, when I look at LinkedIn, like jobs, they're like, oh, you need this. And then I'm like, oh, perfect, I can do this. And then they're like, oh, you need 7 years of experience. And I'm like, what? So, yeah, I just wanted to, you know, understand how you would put yourself out there and kind of market yourself even when you think you're falling short. Yeah.
Just to anybody.
So I think I would start with figuring out what your personal brand is, right? So your name was Larry?
Yeah.
So Larry, how is Larry different from all the other 20-year-olds out there that might have the same degree that you do? Like, what have you done that puts you apart? Like, what is it that you're passionate about? What is it that you're really good at? What is it that, you know, really sets you on fire? What have you done maybe outside your studies or in the few years of experience you have that sets you apart and will mean that when someone's looking through a series of CVs or application, they'll remember yours? I think there was one event we had where Andrew was talking about personal brand. No, Andrea, she did her thing. Yes, no, it was actually the Accenture event.
It was international.
Yeah, so sorry, it was something at our old company. Anyway, a woman who I know is part of this network, she's not here this evening, and she just gave a great and really insightful presentation about how to build your own personal brand. And it went beyond just your CV, but thinking about, you know, your picture on LinkedIn, the words that you use to describe yourself in your profile, like what you respond to, the kind of posts that you do, the kind of conversations that you have online in order to build and really develop this authentic, because starting with the things that you are really passionate about and define you, but then using those through all of these wonderful, you know, technology vehicles that we have available to get that brand out there to people.
Okay, thank you.
I'm just going to go back to, that was someone over there. Yeah, the question. And then we'll come back to you.
Hi, thanks for all your sharings. I have a question for Adriana. I was interested in how you explore different roles within the tech space, because you mentioned you started out as a software engineer and you're now in HR. Could you tell us more about that journey?
Sure. So I had a lot of lateral transitions, I would say, in my career. So I went from in a consulting company in the technology space to in that same consulting company in the talent and organization space to then consulting externally to clients to doing that same work internally for the company. So moving into HR and then from an internal talent strategy role into a more traditional HR role. So at each of these moves, it was definitely lateral, sometimes even a step backwards. because I was stepping out of, you know, an area that I had had and built expertise and had sponsors and mentors into a new space. But at each time, I also knew what it was that I was bringing to this role, back to the previous comment, that would kind of set me apart or be part of my personal brand. So, you know, moving, for example, from a client-facing role into an internal HR role, I knew that I was bringing this experience in change management and stakeholder management and project management that maybe some of my HR colleagues didn't have. So it was a way for me to set myself apart, and even though I was coming in a lateral move or even taking a bit of a step back in my career in order to take that role, I felt comfortable that I had this career capital based on what I'd done before that would then help me move to the next step.
Okay, we're going to do the last couple of questions, so just pass it to you.
Okay. Sorry. Very, very good comments. I'm so glad I came. There were many things I agree, and there are many things I disagree. So no, it's just different experiences. Number one for me, given the choice, I would always choose a man, a male boss over a female, always. Second, and second, why? Because. I have about, let's say, 5 to 6 years of experience, and I work in consulting. And all the bosses that I had who were male, they opened doors for me, they were mentoring me, they were always encouraging, what do you want to do, how can I make it happen? Maybe it's just my good karma, I don't know. Female bosses were always a pain. It's just maybe the women that I met. But just to share with you an example, something really amazing happened to me today. So my boss came to me and he said, forget about billable hours, I just want to harness your creativity. You tell me what you want to do. Next week we're going to meet. You can do whatever you want. You just tell me. I know you're interested, you're in different things, you're creative. How can we build on it? You tell me, for this whole year, you're going to be doing this. How did I do this? How did I get to this offer? I work in consulting, as I said, so billable hours, long hours, whatnot. When they give me a spreadsheet and I look at it, okay, this is going to take me 5 hours to do it. I hate Excel, so how can I do it better? I'll just go on Google, find some other program, and do it in 20 minutes. On the next day, I'll run to my boss and tell him, look, I found this amazing tool. I'll show it to them. Can we use it at work? When I show it to my female colleagues, yeah, whatever. I don't care. They'll just continue working on the Excel. My male bosses, my male colleagues, they would be super duper interested in it. They would immediately want to download it, start playing around with it, and I get the credit because I'm the one who introduced it to them. So for those who asked, what can you start doing now if you want to become more visible? Maybe that's something that you can start doing, is making your boss's life easier. It's either they work on an Excel for 5 hours or you show them something better. I would read books and I would immediately run to my boss. Have you read this book? You really gotta get it. Sign up for National Library, get it. My boss just came to me today. He said, I'm listening now to audiobooks, this and this you recommended. For instance, if I tell it to my female colleagues, my bosses, they're not interested. Time after time, there is not even one female colleague that tried to pay attention, was interested in getting it on their computers, was interested in trying to do it. They would rather sit there until 8 p.m. and do it. I leave work at 5. I go home.
I've got a quick question for you. So I think you've made some awesome points. Putting yourself out there, adding to people's lives, I think that's brilliant. What would you say the things you've taken away from your female bosses that will make you a better boss?
I have an intern who just today got a job offer. I made it happen for him. He's inviting me for a super duper fancy dinner. Anyways, he's a guy. How did I make it happen for him? He's a young grad, Singaporean. He didn't even know that we were interested in his opinion. He would just get work dumped on his desk and he will do it. And 4 months passed. In the last 2 months, I started taking interest in him and started coaching him. And he is very, very happy and very glad. And what he told me today was, you took interest in me. You gave me some valuable advice. Nobody would ever care in giving me this. They would just dump work on me, expect me to do it. I make mistakes. They don't teach me. When he makes mistakes, I immediately take him aside. I teach him. I show him. I coach him. I coach him on how to get higher salary. I coach him on how to do interviews. I coach him on how to work with tools that we have, how to start thinking like a consultant.
Can I interject just quickly? Sorry, it sounds like you're giving a lot of guidance and you're acting in that kind of mentor capacity to this individual, this graduate. But it doesn't have to be people who are less experienced, less senior than you. Part of the education process and part of the maturity of being a good manager is to actually manage up as well. So if you've had a bad experience with a female manager, with any manager, regardless of gender, you are able to affect change in that way as well.
Oh yeah, definitely.
So you know, I think it's a bold statement and perhaps too sweeping a statement to say that, you know, male managers are better at female better than male, it doesn't matter. But you have the ability to actually change your environment, your situation, and your working situation.
I'm just going to just jump in with that. So, no, I think when, honestly, it's a shitty situation that you're in. It sounds like it's not the best situation, but I think one of the big things that I've learned from many of the women on this panel, as well as just having worked around some people for a while, is it sometimes isn't really just about man and woman, it's just sometimes about the character of the individual. For me, when I work, and Shreya knows this, she's my brother, was at Accenture, I don't like the hand-holding. I just want, just tell me what the problem is, let me sort it out. There's some people who work that way, but there are others who need a little bit of help along the way. And then, just like there are some who, well, I know that when it comes to a manager, I like it when I get praise. That makes me feel better. That makes me want to pump work into my job. I've got a girl that I work with who's just like, just tell me what to do. And that's it. I don't need any emotional support because I don't need that shit. That's what she literally said to me yesterday. So I think what you probably need to do at Accenture, I know that we've mentioned Accenture quite a little bit, but
they're sponsoring. Yeah.
With our business, which is also consulting, we have a role called the career counselor. Every single person that comes into the business will have one person who has a sub role, just like what Ria said, which is your career counselor. They are responsible for figuring out what makes you tick, what you love, what drives you, and making sure that you're happy in your role. You need to find someone who's going to help you do that.
Hey Mira, how many women work at Accenture?
36%.
Oh, carry on.
Well, so I just want to add to this. So there's points that I agree with, you know, similar to you, and points that I disagree with. Coming from someone who's had only male career counselors and mentors in the firm, I have to say that it is down to the individual level. Like, I'm the type of person, though, who needs to know your background, needs to know how many kids you have, what you do on the weekend. And there are some men and women who like to know that, or some who just like the facts and like the orders. So I think it's really, how do you align yourself with what you, I think, what really drives you? But also like thinking about how you can both help each other. With women, I think it's because there's such a lower percentage that you may not find women in leadership positions to give you that opportunity to leverage. And some of the women that, there have been instances where there's women that I've approached who I've wanted to have a coffee with and have lunch with, they may have been too busy. And I've reflected on that, and what I've realized is, one, I think I'm one of like 30 women who've just asked them, you know, after meeting them in discussions or panels. And then two, I got a sense that they were hesitant to maybe mentor or meet with me because they didn't want to be seen as another woman helping another woman. So
there should always be another woman
Well, I mean, yes. But like one of those where we're just women helping women? Yes. No, I agree with women helping women, but again, I think it's really, we need to focus on the individual. Individual results, uniqueness. I think we want to help each other, but going back to that, there's so few of us. How do we make, you know, how do we make more of us? But we can't discredit the men.
I agree. You can't. Yeah. It's true. I love the fact that hands are still going up. Really sorry.
Liz, sorry. Could I just add to that? Yeah. Because I just had to like counter that Accenture stats. So in GovTech, in the government technology side of the world, we actually have 40% who are female. Yeah, so we consciously, and for the record, boom! And for the record, my boss, my CEO is a female, and we get really, really excited when we get female talents joining us, and we consciously look out for them because it's hard to find. But attracting them is one thing, making sure they fit into the whole culture and ecosystem is another, and being in public sector is triple, because of the bureaucracy and the paperwork. So, but it's being conscious about it, and it's really working hard at building the culture that makes sure that they feel comfortable and part of the culture.
So awesome.
We're really tight for time, and I see a lot of hands popping up. I'm so sorry. But the speakers will be here after this.
Heather is hiding you, sorry.
So we'll still be able to follow up with them. Now, I think that a lot of people, and this was a great panel, so seriously, thank you. Two things, just in the last one, the topic of technology. So you see up here, there are a couple of books that we've actually pulled together. And I wanted to, we will actually follow up with the speakers to just ask what are some of the books that they recommend you read. We will have a shopping list up on our Facebook page with an Amazon link, so you'll be able to check out the books over there. Now the second thing for those people who are looking for a role in technology, we need to come. So Hoover's here, Google's over there. Trax is over there. Now Trax, that's big. She's looking for, what are you looking for?
We're looking for product marketing managers, marcom managers, who are staffing in regions, so
yeah. And Faye's a hiring manager, and she's awesome to work with. Amazon's here somewhere as well, the hiring manager. No, that is it. But that's Lily, and if anyone's heard of Amazon Web Services, you can talk about a male-dominant business.
Hey, don't throw stones. 36%. Not in Asia.
So that's Amazon there. I know that we've got the guys, some of the folks from Visa here and MasterCard are here, and PNG. So just make yourself known, and if you are looking for a role, those are the guys to talk to. Is that right?
This is what we call recruit her. Yeah. I just made that up. Okay, moving swiftly on. We have something else to introduce. So we do this every couple of months. Very good fun. We're going to introduce something called A Night With. This is where you get to come and just hang out with us in a bar. It's a lot less formal, less panel stuff. Yeah, we could just be friends. You don't have to drink. We're not going to make you. We're not going to go all boys club. The other lovely thing is, you mentioned about being a mentor. We get a lot of requests for being a mentor. So all I say is, can you all just go and be mentors for people? You might not feel like you're willing to be or able to be a mentor. Just go and do it, please. Like, there's so many people out there that need your advice, your chat, your gift of the gab, if you will. Plus, these lovely people are in the room right now. They're the ones with the lanyards. They've got a good bit chat. So feel free to go and ask them any questions, or the lovely panel. It's been an awesome night. Can I ask for one final round of applause?
I've got one last request.
What?
I need a selfie with the panel behind me and the whole audience.
Lizzie's having a best process moment. The whole audience. Does anyone have a selfie stick? I'm sure someone does. There you go.
I could do a 360.
Oh, no.
I could do a 360 if you want. Okay, no.
Everybody stay.
Could I do a 360 as well? But can I request to do a 360 photo? Yeah. All right. Hang on. Let me just sync up with this thing. Sorry. Give me a moment. Almost there.
What is this?
It's a 360 camera. So yeah. So it's, I think it takes. Yeah. Just look at the black thing. Ready? 1, 2, go. And we're done.